Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I also was taught to speak Czech, so I will skip to this language. Dobré ráno. Vítám na tomto panelu, který budu moderovat. Tři osobnosti, které téměř ani nemusím představovat, protože jsou asi vám všeobecně známé. Přesto si dovolím krátce představit po mé pravici Lukáše Kaminského, který působil dlouho na univerzitě ve Vroclavi a především od roku 2000 v různých pozicích na Polském ústavu paměti národa. Od roku 2011 je ředitelem tohoto obrovského a velmi důležitého zásadního institutu. Takže dobrý den, dobré ráno. Po mé levici sedí Laure Neumayer, když si dovolím přečíst to takhle německy, což údajně nevadí, jak říkala Laure Neumayer. Studovala politologii na Sciences Po v Paříži a je známá například jako spoluautorka nebo spolueditorka také knihy, významné knihy History, Memory and Politics in Central and Eastern Europe, Memory Games, která vyšla poměrně nedávno. V současné době působí jako profesorka politologie na Sorboně v Paříži. A posledním panelistou, třetím panelistou je Michal Kopeček, můj kolega z Ústavu pro soudobé dějiny, který zároveň také učí moderní české dějiny na Filozofické fakultě Karlovy univerzity. Takže tímto všechny vás vítám. My jsme se s kolegy domluvili, že to téma tohoto panelu je samozřejmě velmi, velmi komplexní. Pád komunismu a jeho následky, dědictví studené války v Evropě. Přinejmenším obsahuje dvě vlastně dost odlišná témata k diskuzi v těch obou částech toho názvu, to znamená pád komunismu a jeho následky a potom druhá otázka, otázka dědictví a reflexe studené války nebo státního socialismu, komunismu jako takového. Dohodli jsme se tedy, že pojmeme nejprve tyto dvě témata odděleně a poté, co tedy se pokusíme tady v rámci toho panelu odpovědět aspoň na některé otázky, které se k tomu vážou, tak doufám, bude alespoň 20 minut nebo půl hodinka na to, abychom diskutovali obě témata potom najednou všichni společně. Těch otázek, které se váží k tomu, už k tomu prvnímu tématu, to znamená rok 1989 nebo pád komunismu ve středovýchodní Evropě zejména a to, co následovalo, je opět mnoho. Dovolil bych si formulovat ty nejdůležitější nebo ty, které mě případně nám připadají jako nejdůležitější, což v první řadě je otázka interpretace roku 1989. Jak můžeme interpretovat tuto událost, to znamená, je to spíše demokratická revoluce, liberální revoluce, neoliberální, kapitalistická revoluce, je to vůbec revoluce nebo něco jiného. Čili první takový balíček otázek. Druhá otázka je, jak tedy se tyto interpretace, zda se nějak zásadně proměňují v čase. Zda tedy jsme se na pád komunismu, na to, co to vlastně znamená, co to je za událost, dívali jinak na počátku 90. let a díváme se na to jinak dneska, nebo jestli je to spíš pluralita interpretací, které vlastně paralelně existují po celou tu dobu vedle sebe. A poslední takový balíček otázek k tomuto dílčímu tématu, byť taky velikému, je tedy co vlastně tyto interpretace, co ten výklad roku 1989, to, jak mu rozumíme, způsobuje. Jaký má ten pohled způsob, jak se díváme na pád komunismu a jak ho vykládáme, vlastně vliv na to, co následovalo, jaká očekávání pád komunismu probouzel a která a z jakých důvodů zůstala nenaplněna. Čili celý komplex otázek, my jsme se domluvili s panelisty, že samozřejmě je možné taky si vybrat jenom některé z nich, protože za tu dobu, která, za ten čas, který zde je nám vyměřen, nestihneme všechno. Proto bych už, ať dále nezdržuju, tedy se s tímto balíkem otázek obrátil nejprve na Lauru Neumayer.
Thank you. Good morning. Well, first I would like to thank the organizers of the conference for giving me the opportunity to be here today and to discuss the question of the interpretations of 1989 and the legacy of the Cold War period with this audience. And I would like to say also that, unlike many people here, I think I'm not a historian, I'm a political scientist. And when I look at the question of the interpretations of 1989, what I find very striking is the diversity of these interpretations and the fact that it seems that there is, in no post-communist country today, there is a consensus on closing the file of the communist past, if I may say so. And on the contrary, it seems that the importance of that past for political life may be even growing with time, probably because the moral and social political consequences of this period have not been really checked, resolved, or overcome. It seems to me that there is this longing for moral clarity that Marcy Shaw was talking about yesterday, which is very, very important in those societies and probably even growing with the time. And one element which may account for this importance of remembrance issues, maybe in my view, and this conference actually is an illustration of that, is the fact that you have more and more non-state actors involved in these remembrance issues. And that's a general trend, it's not specific to Central Europe. But alongside state bodies or politicians, you have a number of NGOs, associations, but also archivists, journalists, historians, who engaged in remembrance issues, who engaged in what we called in the book you mentioned memory games, that is some specific ways of relating to the past in order to construct some group identities, in order to redefine position in the political or the social sphere, in order to designate or stigmatize enemies in political competitions. So I think that there are many, many uses of this past by a plurality of actors, which uses which keep the issue very much alive. I don't mean that in a negative way or in a kind of cynical or opportunistic way. I think it also probably reflects a need to really discuss what that period was, and also a search for recognition of past injustice, past wrongdoings by various groups in those societies. So I don't think we should take a negative or a cynical views on these remembrance activities. But at the same time, I think, and for political scientists, but also for historians, for social scientists in general, it's important to try to put these interpretations of the past and these discussions about the past in the social and political context in which they are produced, and to try to have some distance to understand who is producing which interpretation of the past and how these interpretations are negotiated, contested, because That's probably one of the main legacy of 1989, this diversity of views and the possibility to debate on these issues. So I think we should be very cautious as social scientists not to reify the memory of communism. They are contested in every nation, and I think it's a good thing. First of all, because it gives us something to study, but also because it's a sign of one of the major success of these events of 1989, even if those same events are being contested and discussed, like the roundtable talks, for example, or the many discussions about the archives and the management of archives, etc. So, I think that it's a sign of a renewal of democratic debates, and that it's very interesting for us as political scientists or historians to really look closely at those memory makers or memory communities and how they interact with each other within those societies.
Tak děkuji za tenhle ten vlastně spíš ještě obecnější úvod k té naší debatě, který je důležitý. Poprosil bych teď Lukáše Kaminského, jestli by se mohl dostat právě k té otázce roku 89 a očekávání, která zbuzoval a případně příčiny jejich nenaplnění.
Okay, and can I answer also the question about the term of revolution? And,
of course.
Thank you very much. So I will start with this problem. And in my opinion, there is no better word than revolution to describe the events of 1989. And of course, in most cases, negotiations with authorities were important and even most important part of the events. However, they would not have taken place without the mass social pressure on politics, both from the side of authorities, communist authorities, and the opposition. And we can also look for some adjectives to this word of revolution, various adjectives for various countries, and some of them are historical ones, like Velvet Revolution, in case of Czechoslovakia, and some of them were invented during last years, for example, the term of limited revolution for Poland. The author of this term is Professor Antoni Dudek, and he wrote a book with this title, Limited Revolution. And his idea is that the Polish case is a specific because the major part of change was negotiated with authorities, and there was only one event with huge involvement of society. It was the first round of election in June 1989, so that's why the limited revolution. And in my view, terms as democratic, liberal, neoliberal, capitalistic in relation to these events cannot be used. This is due to the fact that most participants of the events did not know what democracy, liberalism and capitalism were. Everyone just wanted freedom and improvement in the economical situation. And it did not translate into any concrete political program. And in my opinion, the best adjective that can be added to the term of revolution is anti-communist revolution. And of course, I realize that this phrase of anti-communist is maybe not so popular in intellectual debates and is burdened by many political contexts. But the only thing which was common for all of these people on the streets of East Central Europe in 1989 was opposition to the reality of those days, so to the reality of to the communists. So they wanted to change the situation, so that's why I found this term anti-communist revolution as the best one for the whole region. And about the interpretations, the problem is that the first interpretations of the events of 1989 were created not by historians or other scientists, but by participants of the events, journalists, and some other groups of the society. And I think there are three main interpretations of this revolution of 1989. So the first one is popular revolt or revolution. And the second one is reasonable settlement between the allies of authorities and opposition. And of course, the third one is conspiracy theory. And the three main conspiracy theories are a collusion of the communists and the opposition leaders, a conspiracy of secret services, and finally, a brilliant and ingenious plan of the Kremlin, so-called maskirovka operation. So everything was planned by Kremlin to keep the influence in the East Central Europe. And this interpretation were true in different countries and in different periods. However, it is difficult to identify any clear trends in the region. I think we could describe this history for each country in various way. And of course, there is a second clear division or interpretative division, and it is concerning the question if the events could have unfolded differently, and of course, presumably better, and if it was possible to avoid various political, social, and economic problems after 1989. And in this situation, historians studying the events of 1989 had to confront entrenched beliefs and myths. And first major analysis based on archival material, not only on materials like testimonies of witnesses, began to appear approximately 10 years ago. And in most of these works, there is a tendency to weight the role of social pressure and negotiations of the alliance. With access to the files of the Secret Service, it is possible now, at least partially, to determine the role of the communist security apparatus. And of course, these works also touch upon elements rarely present in not present in the public debate, that is the impact of Gorbachev policy, reformist tendencies, the Communist Party's economic situation, etc. But it seems, however, that impact of historians on the popular image or social image of the events is quite small. And we need to remember that the state of research in different countries is highly diverse, starting from just one, two books about those events to dozens of them in respective countries. And finally, the problem of influence of this interpretation of political cultures. In my opinion, in the all countries of our part of Europe, in varying degrees, of course, the already mentioned interpretations have had impact of on political life, at least in some periods of time. For example, some political forces referred to the tradition of the 1989, that were the descendants of this tradition of revolution of 1989. On contrary, some, on the other hand, mobilized very opponents, criticizing the course of events. And using the Polish example, for example, slogans like down with the round table republic or breaking with the round table system became popular at the time, especially a few years ago. And the problem of expectations. There were really, really great expectations in 1989. So disappointment was also great, starting, of course, with economy, because everyone expected fast improvement of the economical situation, and in many cases there was no improvement for many years, and even worsening of the situation in this sphere of economy. With time, there appeared also disillusionment with new political class and new alliance, and for many they have ceased to be different from those of the communist era. And the last sentence, I think in many circles there is also a strong disappointment with the problem of justice. And many people are saying now. There is no justice. There is no punishment for communist criminals. There are no adequate compensation for the victims of the system. Thank you very much.
Moc krát děkuju vlastně za i za tu snahu zodpovědět vlastně všechny ty otázky velmi stručně a zároveň komplexně, takže díky. Michal Kopeček má teď trochu výhodu, že může jak se snažit zodpovědět ty původní otázky, tak vlastně už i trochu třeba reagovat na něco, co tady padlo, jako je pojem antikomunistická revoluce nebo to rozdělení vlastně těch hlavních interpretací na spontánní, vyjednané, případně konspirační teorie, respektive na vliv historiků. Padlo tu, že vliv historiků a jejich interpretací na ty všeobecné nebo populární výklady je poměrně malý, čili několik aspektů, na něž se vlastně taky dá navázat. Předávám slovo.
Thank you very much. I apologize to the Czech audience because I prepared for the panel. I was supposing it is going to be let in English, so my notes are in English and I'm going to speak in English too. So first, let me try to touch the issue of the interpretations of 1989. I think what we have to bear in mind when talking about interpretations indeed, and I think that actually both Laure and Łukasz already touched upon this topic, is that from the very beginning, the interpretations of 1989 were part of democracy building, were part of nation building, were part of political community building in the post-communist Europe and partly, however, also in the West. So the understanding of the nature of events in 1989 and how to tackle the totalitarian legacy became, and we can see it in all of the countries, at least in East Central Europe, which is my area of specialization, became one of the fundamental cleavages forming the nascent political spectrum, particularly the post-opposition, that is post-solidarity, post-civic forum political spectrum after 1989. But I think it seems to me that the 1989 within, let's say, broader narratives of European and democratic modernity became also a part of the political contest and of different political identity buildings also in Western countries. So from this point of view, it is quite natural that the quarrels whether 1989 was a revolution and what kind of revolution it was obviously a part of the package. Now, the liberal elite of early 90s, if you allow to call it like that, with all the qualifications of the term, liberal elite of the 1990s was claiming we are building, obviously, a new political order. We are, in a way, renewing the natural evolution patterns of these societies. So we really did revolutions, albeit, and we know, these were non-violent revolutions, these were negotiated revolutions, and these aspects obviously were presented as one, and I think rightly so, as one of the greatest achievements of the revolutionary elites. This revolution, however, also had some kind of conservative or restorative tinge, which was captured in the famous Habermas notion of catching up revolutions, nachholende Revolution, and so we are renewing, we are coming back to something what has been here before. Now this, if you allow me to call it like that, liberal interpretations were challenged by those who were challenging the newly created liberal consensus in the early 1990s. There were many of them already during the 1990s and increasingly in late 1990s challenging the notion of revolution. It was no real setting accounts with communism. It was no real social, or there was no real social political catharsis. Łukasz was pointing to the sense of lack of justice. This was just mere roundtable deal of the old communist and the new post-communist political elite. Now it is, I would say, just recently that truly historical accounts, not maybe of 1989, there are a couple of wonderful books already produced in 1990s, but very importantly, first accounts of the what we can call popular receptions of the changes in 1989 are appearing. One of the best examples is James Krapfel's book, The Revolution with Human Face, which is describing the popular ideals and popular perceptions of the Velvet Revolution in Czechoslovakia in the time of the most authentic democratic movement, which was beating the dynamic of the revolution at the turn of 1989-1990 in Czechoslovakia. And what Krapfl is showing in his book is that the main principles that are beating this democratic movement or democratization movement are nonviolence, are self-organization of the society, fairness, socialism, interestingly, however vaguely understood or vaguely formulated, obviously human rights and humanitarianism. In other words, it shows that the immediate understanding of the event in 1989, I think, again, Łukasz was already mentioning it, was above all a democratic revolution that brings with it political entitlements that, however, does not take away the social provisions that the state socialist orders were offering. It was only later, but not very much later, I would say, I would see it in 1991, 1992, that the understanding of the events in 1989 as a liberal revolutions or liberal democratic end of history, to put it with Francis Fukuyama, started to take roots not only in the West, but also in at least East Central Europe. And I think that it was a mixture of interests and mixture of processes here. You mentioned the most important of them is obviously, from one hand, the interpretation that would be spilling over from the West, from the Western liberal understanding of 1989. Books were published by major Western left liberal, mostly left liberal political thinkers such as Dahrendorf, Fukuyama, Garton-Esch, Rupnik, Ackermann, and many others, who are interpreting 1989 as Bruce Ackermann put it, liberal, liberal revolutions. The second aspect would be a search of or for specific political identity that led part of the post-dissident camp to drift from anti-political, whatever, proto-liberalism to some kind of social liberalism, political political identities. So we have free democrats in Hungary, you have the similar free democrats in Czech politics, you have Unia Wolności in Poland. And perhaps more, most importantly, there was a rise of technocratic and expert elites in the political lives of these countries in East Central Europe, partly coming from former party cadres and socialist managers, that picked up very much on these liberal market thesis and started to push through the liberal, I would say, maybe we can put it like that, liberal capitalist interpretation of the meaning of 1989. So what we have in contrast to the, you know, democratic revolution as a popular perception in 1989, what we have, let's say, in 1992, is the political elite, despite the popular discontent about it, is having or establishing a consensus that 1989 gave way to liberal, democratic, and pro-capitalist revolution. So something that nowadays is, by its critiques, called the establishment of neoliberal consensus. So this would be, I would say, at least for the first half of 1990s, the dominant political narrative that has been challenged, however, from very early on, I would say, at least in terms of interpretation, from, let's say, both sides. One would be the radical left, and we know now that, or we always knew, that part of the radical leftist critique came also from post-dissident circles. Their argument is connecting exactly to the popular receptions and popular understanding and experiences in 1989. Revolutions with popular democratic participation, revolutions with self-organizing character. Yes, from the left wing point of view, they were negotiated, they were non-violent, but they were also radical in social terms. And as such, these revolutions were betrayed and sold to Western companies and for Western consumer goods. So instead of what the people were dreaming about in 1989, instead of new democracy, we actually got political capitalism. So this is an interpretation that was sort of simmering long time under the surface, is sort of getting more importance in recent years, with along with something what we called the rise of a new left in the region. But it was also a, I would say, more right-wing, conservative of different kinds, conservative, traditionalist, populist challenge to the liberal consensus and liberal interpretation, which, interestingly enough, had partly similar argument. Revolution of 1989 were mass democratic movement, popular revolutions that were actually betrayed by liberal post-communist elites. But obviously, from the right-wing point of view, the meaning of 1989 had a different emphasis. It was anti-communist revolution, come back to traditional national, community or religious life, etc., which was hindered by the swift neoliberal transformation and some kind of formalistic and non-organic implementation of European community. Our European community rules. Now, you understand that I am simplifying in order to put it in, let's say, broader terms. So instead, from the right-wing point of view, instead of a return to natural path of national history, what we have is another elite project. The communist project was elite project, the liberal project too was too much elite concerned and elite oriented project. Now, as I said, whereas the radical left criticism of 1989 or liberal interpretation of 1989 is rising in the recent years, the, let's say, right-wing or conservative challenge was on the rise. On the turn of 1990s, 2000s, I think that Poland, but also Czech Republic, are among the best examples with the Institutes of National Memory or Institutes for the Study of Totalitarian Regimes being actually, so to say, institutional result of this change of the interpretation. And if I have still 2 minutes more, then I would like to come to the last question. What influence these interpretations have on political cultures of the countries we are speaking about? And I would have only 2 points. One is politics of history, the other is what we call now a transition paradigm. So it has an immense influence. Just if we have the liberal interpretation, 1989 was indeed a revolution, but it was non-violent revolution, negotiated revolution. We have to represent, obviously, publicly, the radical difference between the old state socialist or communist regime, communist dictatorship, and the new regime. The result of this need was a huge institutional and symbolic mechanisms of the so-called coming to terms with the communist past. If you read the newspaper from 1990s, coming to terms with the communist past is all present formula and not by chance. So it's starting with opening archives of the communist parties. It's starting with, you know, establishing historical institutions. By the way, the institute that is co-organizing it, this conference, Institute for Contemporary History, is a part of this of these processes. Rehabilitations, restitutions, illustrations, up to, you know, renaming public spaces and symbolic spaces, etc. So there is immense energy of the new states invested into something that I would call politics of history, not politics of memory yet, because it is not based on one certain sort of memory layer in the society, but it is politics of history in this kind of liberal anti-totalitarianism fashion. Second point. If we, in the liberal way, interpret the revolutions as, in many ways, come back to the old good patterns of liberal democracy that is functioning in the West, and I would just remind you the watchword "return to Europe," which implied, among other things, also this comeback to the old proven structures and mechanisms, then obviously the rectification is quite obvious. The rectification is application of the standard systems and standard mechanisms and institutions that are functioning elsewhere. So that is what is nowadays, by its critique, called a transition paradigm, the idea that democracy, functioning market, and civil society could be somehow transplanted and cultivated with the help of money and, of course, activism from outside. Now, the question is to what extent this kind of transition paradigm has been or has not been successful in East Central Europe, and how, to what extent it is successful maybe in other East European countries or even outside Europe. This is a question for another discussion. Thank you.
Děkuji za tu poměrně komplexní a zároveň precizní odpověď, nebo odpověď se s velkou snahou o preciznost. Myslím, že tam bylo řada věcí, vlastně i nakonec polemických, a doufám, že se k tomu dostaneme v diskuzi, kterou bych ale přeci jenom odročil ještě na čas poté, co v rámci panelu se pokusíme o odpověď na ten druhý balík otázek, to znamená to, co patří taky k našemu tématu, to znamená dědictví, vlastně to, jakým způsobem se potýkáme s dědictvím státního socialismu, socialistické diktatury, komunistického režimu jako takového. Vidíte, že už v těchto pojmech vězí celá řada interpretací. Rád bych tedy zase s panelistům položil několik otázek, v zásadě alespoň stručně zrekapitulovat, co v jednotlivých zemích nebo oblastech, případně na východě a na západě od bývalé železné opony, vlastně co se stalo tou dominantní interpretací, dominantním narrativem poválečných dějin, nebo tedy dějin státně socialistických diktatur, a zda v tomto ohledu můžeme sledovat zase na západě, na východě nějaký výrazný vývoj, tedy nakolik se objevují a prosazují v posledních letech interpretace revizionistické, nebo jak je budeme nazývat, které tyhle ty dominantní narrativy, tyhle ty převládající výklady nějakým způsobem nahrazují nebo přinejmenším částečně zpochybňují. A s tím souvisí to, co už tady bylo vlastně zmíněno v souvislosti s tím prvním komplexem otázek nebo s tím prvním tématem, to znamená, jaká vůbec je v tomhletom vyjednávání interpretace minulosti role historiků, jak moc jsou historici relevantní vlastně z hlediska politiky a politiků, jakou v tomto vyjednávání hrajou roli. Zase bych poprosil, jestli může začít Laure Neumayer.
Thank you. I think you've given us a rich agenda and a lot of questions, and obviously I won't be able to touch upon all of them. I think what I would like to try to focus on, because that may be an important point for our discussion with the audience later on, is the legacy of the Cold War period in Europe, in the western part and the eastern part of Europe, and also what it means for the EU and for the EU politics of memory, because I think in the post-Cold War Europe we are obviously in a radical new environment, and that has had some direct consequences on how the past can be assessed and presented also in European institutions. So I think that's one of the maybe another defining characteristic of the current times is the internationalization of memory issues, the multiplications of arenas where remembrance policies are being put forward, where memory policies are crafted, and also arenas where demands for material or mainly symbolic compensations are made in accordance with norms which are produced by the Council of Europe or by the European Union. And that's not a new phenomenon, obviously. Since the 1950s and 1970s for the EU, these organizations have started to implement a set of policies which aimed at fostering European identity, strengthening the basis of a transnational political community. But I think that the end of the Cold War and the reassessment of the past in the former Eastern Bloc has changed the context and the meaning of those transnational memory policies. The point being now not only to bring to the fore shared history, common values, etc., but also these institutions have had to find ways to meet these new demands for recognition and reparation of past times and injustices. And we have seen a very active movement, mainly between 2004 and 2009 in the EU, but also in the Council of Europe previously, where the vague of commemorations and or condemnation of past events, and to give you just a few examples, between 2004 and 2009, the European Parliament has adopted resolutions to condemn the crimes of the communist totalitarian regimes, to commemorate the Holodomor, the famine in Ukraine. To commemorate or condemn the Franco regime, the Srebrenica massacre, or to commemorate the Budapest uprising from 1956. I mean, there is quite a long list of events which were interpreted in a pan-European way as having a pan-European significance. What it means is that these European organizations, the European Parliament and also the Parliamentary Assembly of the Council of Europe, which was a very important venue for these mobilizations, so these institutions have been the stage for those new memory demands in order either to produce consensus and therefore to pacify social relations, or on the other hand, on the contrary, to reopen certain aspects of a repressed history, in which case the desired effect might be distinction, symbolic recognition, or integration into national narratives or into a European narrative which is permanently being negotiated. So, and I think one of the important aspects of this new trend is the fact that we have seen a kind of memory gap between the Western and the Eastern part of the European Union, because the fact that you had some kind of a clash between the EU on the one hand with its normative reconciliation principle, the temptation to try to unite European memory around the uniqueness of the Holocaust as an integral part of the acquis communautaire. It was part of the conditions to enter the EU. So on the one hand, this long-lasting memory or historical policy of the EU, and on the other hand, the new member states from the former Eastern Bloc with their determination to get the experience of the Soviet dictatorships or Soviet totalitarian regimes incorporated into the foundation of European historical legitimacy. So again, with this search for recognition and for recognition as equal partners or as equal members of this European political community. And I think that that clash was made probably more important because you had this conditionality on the one hand of the enlargement and some kind of geopolitical asymmetry, if you wish, between the older member states and the new member states. And to give you some examples also, there were long debates about the question of the Yalta agreements, how to interpret them and how whether and how the EU should make official statements about that. Another broad debate is, and very complex debate, is the one about the equivalence or the comparison of Nazism and communism, and also the consequences, the political and legal consequences of these comparisons. So I think that maybe one of the main legacy of the Cold War, and which is still very present and very alive in the EU, is this this memory gap, and the fact that these memory makers or memory milieu consider the EU as an arena for settling competing or sometimes converging, but usually competing demands on differentiated memories. And I think it's a real challenge for the EU, which is trying to develop a memory culture, which would be setting some common standards or some common ways of dealing with those painful histories. And that's a very, it's a challenge, and it means it requires, I think, a complex mix of empathy, but also pragmatism to overcome this this memory gap. Thank you.
Děkuji za tenhle ten vstup, zejména za to srovnání právě toho pohledu západu a východu, které se týká nejenom konkrétní interpretace státního socialismu, ale i to, jakou relevanci vlastně v té celkové krajině vzpomínání tahle ta éra má. Předal bych teď slovo Lukáši Kamińskému.
Thank you. I hope I will provoke other panelists and the audience for discussion with my first thesis, because in my opinion, we cannot talk about any single dominant narrative on the post-war period in the whole region. There are various reasons. The two main reasons are significant differences in state of research, in state of art, between the countries, and the lack of comparative approach. So I see, because of these two reasons, we cannot say now that there is one dominant narrative on post-war history in East Central, Europe. Of course, there are very many similarities. Some of them were mentioned already, but again, no one single dominant narrative. And in my view, what we are dealing here with is rather a continuous process of re-evaluation of the image of communism due to the progress in research. And of course, this process is different in respective countries. And in those countries, countries of our region, historians repeatedly argue whether the regime was totalitarian or not, about society's attitudes, especially about and the extent of support for communists is, I think, one of the common problems in these historians' discussions, about the scale of and significance of opposition and resistance, the role of churches, and whether a communist can become a national hero. It's a good example of Imre Noč in Hungary and Alexander Dubček in case of Czech Republic and Slovakia. And of course, on the political, very high level, the dominating vision of the communist era in the region is one of captivity and fight for freedom. We were captive nations, and all the time we fought for our freedom. And I would say that there is even a certain rivalry between countries. Who suffered bigger losses, who started the resistance against communists, and who contributed the most to the collapse of the system. I think we can accept this last part. We can expect that this last problem will be discussed also during this year, who was the first and who was the most involved in the collapse of the communist system. And the second problem, what is the political relevance of historians and their narratives? And it is obvious that the history of World War II and the communist dictatorship is an important point of reference for nations of East Central Europe when constructing, or maybe better is to say reconstructing their national identity after communism. And what is most of the people active in the public life today were active in 1989 or even before 1989. So that's why the contemporary history evokes emotions. That's why it's so sensitive problem in at least majority of our of countries of our region. But I think that these emotions are strongest probably in Poland, in my country. For example, all the most important authorities, including president, prime minister, or deputies, etc., took part in the discussion about the Jedwabne crime, which was mentioned yesterday, or the book on the cooperation of Lech Wałęsa with the communist secret services. I don't know if in any other country there was a so huge discussion about the book written by historians. Of course, in this situation, the significance of historians working on these subjects and institutions such as Institute of National Remembrance is substantial. And they can greatly affect the public opinion, both in positive and in negative manner. So that's why we, as historians, or as this kind of institution, are so responsible for the situation in our countries. Thank you.
Také děkuji. Znova vlastně byla zmíněna ta soutěž o uznání, byť v tom prvním případě u Laury Neumayer spíše se jednalo o soutěž o uznání nebo soupeření o uznání mezi jednotlivými skupinami, ale vlastně se to týká i států nebo národů v tomto smyslu, jakkoliv si nejsem jistý, jestli Česká republika se té soutěže chce účastnit nebo účastní, ale padly i jiné důležité věci, možná provokativní v tom smyslu, že neexistuje žádný dominantní narrativ, žádný dominantní výklad, k tomu se ještě určitě dostaneme potom v diskuzi. Teď předám slovo Michalu Kopečkovi.
Well, I would just exactly connect to this question and well, maybe actually I was about to speak about dominant narrative, but at the same time now reacting to Łukasz, I would actually agree that it's difficult to speak about narrative, but maybe we can speak about a frame, a social frame and social political frame that is shaping narratives. And in this sense, I would still stick to what I was talking about in the first part, and that is that if there was a dominant frame, narrative frame in the 1990s, it was definitely, in East Central Europe at least, the liberal anti-totalitarianism, which obviously due to the moral authority and historical legitimacy of the dissidents could be also called the post-dissident liberal anti-totalitarianism in East Central Europe, which in a way indeed hegemonized to some extent the historical discourse of the period, especially about the communist past in these years. So what is this narrative? To put it very simply, in general terms, it is narrative of young and weak democracies in the region after 1918 being throughout the 20s and 30s seduced or swallowed by totalitarian dictatorships, the Nazi one or the communist one. Then in the time coming through various disillusions, revolts, failed reformist attempts and endeavors through in 1970s the turn to human rights and democratic values up to 1989, the democratic or liberal democratic revolutions 1989. A narrative to much extent or too often, I would say, built on a simplified image or simplified dichotomy of recent European and global history, of which looks at it as a fight of evil totalitarianism and authoritarianism on one hand against the freedom loving democracy, is something that I believe Peter Lagru is going to touch upon in his lecture tomorrow. Now, this politically expedient tool, which I allow myself to call usable totalitarianism, is maybe understandable and maybe even to some extent legitimate as a tool of political mobilization, but it certainly is hardly a tool for any sensible historical analysis. And I'm here referring actually to the keynote lecture by Marcy Shore yesterday, where she depicted some of the most profound analysis of the totalitarian phenomenon in the 20th century history, which is exactly sort of challenging this kind of dichotomic view. Now, I'm not sure if there is a fundamental difference between the East and West, as in both cases, in terms of function of these narratives, because in both cases, the recent history is arguably the most important plane for reconsideration of collective identities. In both cases, the dichotomy of liberal democracy versus the totalitarian temptation or totalitarian danger plays an important role in identity building and thus also an important role in constructing the historical narratives or historical emplotments. Yet if I would see a difference, that would be a difference of stages. Whereas a major threat in the West, which arguably in many cases was the fascist threat, is long time gone. In the East, the major threat, that is the communist dictatorship, is not that long time gone. So therefore, the ways and means of dealing with this past still play different role in present political, social, legal, also pedagogical, institutional life of these societies. If you allow me to put it in other words, whereas in the Western countries, the balance, not all of them obviously too, the balance between the normative political memory, such as that of Holocaust, and the inherent plurality of social memories in the society is more, maybe not fixed, but more stabilized or stable. In the East, including East Central Europe, this balance is not yet fixed, since the political memory as a normative account about the recent past is still very much contested, or is very much still in the making, if you want. Now, do I see interpretations challenging this dominant narrative or narrative frame? Surely, I think there were challenging narratives from the very beginning, obviously. Łukasz was mentioning some of them, the conspiracy theories. There were revisionist accounts already in the beginning of 1990s that were completely rejecting the liberal democratic meaning or interpretation of 1989. There were nostalgic narratives extolling actually the idealized pictures of socialist past, in contrast to the what they depicted as bleak neo-capitalist present. So there were definitely challenging narratives. Another thing, another question is, however, if and when these narratives can become socially or politically relevant, or whether they are actually remaining to be at a marginal position in the society. Now, if you let me to come back shortly to 1989 and the major paradoxes, one of the major paradoxes, as we know, of these revolutions in East Central Europe was an effort to create a democratic community consensus based on obviously explicit rejection of communism, while at the same time striving towards political and pragmatic agreement with the communist leadership at the round tables in the name of peaceful societal change. Hence, there was a basic discrepancy between, on one hand, the legitimization practices of these regimes, which are denouncing state socialism as a totalitarian order or embodiment of historical evil, and the pragmatic need of politics, which needs a consensus, including the former communists. Now, I already talked about it, how this led to this massive politics of history of the early liberal democratic regimes, which were based on certain apparatuses. You know, it was the law and legal mechanisms, transitional justice, the whole field of social research and legal research was playing an important role here. Lustrations, trials are just the most explicit examples. There was historical research, opening archives, etc. But it was also based on a certain key notions. I mentioned the anti-totalitarianism, moderate anti-communism, language of historical truth versus the historical falsification that was here from the time of communist dictatorship, and this idea that the main thing that historians and historical research has to do is to fill the white spots on the recent, on the map of recent history. Despite this massive investment into the liberal politics of history, with the gradual disappearance of what Ivan Krastev, for instance, calls the liberal consensus of the 1990s, this liberal historical narrative or frame, if you want, soon became to be an object of criticism and revision. And again, I think that Poland in the turn of 90s and 2000s, with the culmination of law and justice government, would be one of the most explicit examples, but we see actually the same development also elsewhere in most of the other countries in the region. So the liberal frame, along with the liberal politics of history, has been challenged and replaced partly by not politics of history, but this time politics of memory, that is based on differently understood democratic and resistance traditions. So this is less the dissident movement, it's more the radical and anti-communist resistance fight on which this politics of memory is building on. It's based also on positively reformulated national and state patriotism. But I would claim that actually, in general terms, this conservative or conservative liberal, in some cases, turn did not actually differ conceptually from the former liberal one that much. It was also based on a notion of anti-totalitarianism. It's also based on this kind of positivist idea that there is a possibility to discern the historical truth found in the archives against the falsities of the opponents, etc. There is one huge difference, however, and this is my last point in this section, one huge difference, and it is obviously the role of the memory. Because in the 1990s, the memory was, and memory landscape was still considered to be a landscape of pluralism, but memory was not the main tool by by which we are actually driving the politics of history. Now, in the new politics of memory in the region after, let's say, early to, or in the 2000s, this region and these policies are reconnecting to the whole European and partly global phenomenon of upsurge of memory, which is challenging, obviously, the role that historical sciences has played or have played so far in the production of the political memories and politically usable historical narratives so far in the society. Thank you.
Tak, také děkuji. Nějaký čas nám ještě zbývá, takže teď je příležitost pro všechny, pro kohokoliv položit otázku nebo pokud možno krátce komentovat to, co bylo řečeno s ohledem na ostatní, kteří také se budou chtít dostat ke slovu. Děkuji za ohleduplnost v tomto smyslu. Tak viděl jsem, asi bude potřeba mluvit do mikrofonu, které zřejmě, ano, už.
Thank you very much. My name is Andrea Simonyi and I come from Budapest, Hungary, where many of the issues just mentioned are very, very relevant on a daily level. And I'd like to comment on three points I heard in the discussions or the presentations. One is the term anti-communist revolution. I think as a person growing up in this era, from young to middle-aged, we experienced the 89 turn as a peaceful, negotiated turn. And this strong expression, anti-communist revolution, came into use only 4 years ago, more and more strongly, and taking a turn of what was mentioned, more of a populist edge to it. When a pre-war arrangement of society or political discourse is being, there is a strong effort to restore that kind of discourse. Also, I think it was Laure who mentioned the clash of remembrance, and I think I am part of this group because of a Holocaust remembrance project, and we are more and more experiencing the difficulty of this kind of a clash. And our understanding is that there should be a much more serious research into the interplay of these two historical eras, which partly chronologically followed each other. And it's just an area that we feel it's an oversimplification, and it's an again and again upcoming clash in discussion whether we should analyze the two set of memories parallelly or against each other. But it's actually a very, very complex story that needs to be questioned, because it's almost like continuation. Even in the case of personal stories, very often people who were perpetrators in the, for example, in Hungary, in the Arrow Cross regime, ended up to be communists a few years later. And very specifically, our project is to bring the memory of the Holocaust to the churches. So also the role of the churches was mentioned. And our experience is that at least in Eastern Central Europe, the role of the churches is much more far-reaching than is normally what I have heard so far normally discussed here. And I think it's very, very important to see their role in the restoration tendencies, to go back to the era of the 1920s, 1930s, also how in the 1920s, at the wake of the First World War, the church is intertwined with the building up of the new national identities, either in Hungary or Slovakia, these are the two countries I can speak more often. So these are the comments quickly I'd like to make. Thank you.
Děkuji, tak byly to spíše komentáře, ale určitě se k ním taky mohou panelisté vrátit. Já bych poprosil, dáme slovo několika řečníkům z publika a pak bychom udělali další kolečko tady v rámci panelu, aby co nejvíc z vás mohlo promluvit.
Okay, yeah. Well, sorry, I couldn't resist, but the question of the single narrative, I think maybe there is no single narrative internally in the Central and Eastern European countries, but definitely there is an external single narrative, and I'm not you know, making this up. You can check it on the YouTube. Eugene Weber, well-known historian, when he was giving his lectures, which were filmed, and many of them are available on YouTube, under the name Western Tradition, in one of the series, which was dedicated to the Cold War, he is showing the division of East and West. And the point that he's making, this is the 1970s, is that the division, that the border that runs between East and West is exactly the border between the Charlemagne Empire and the Roman Empire that existed in the past. So his point, and this is, well, you know, it's been contested, of course, but at least that was, you can say that the major point of view or prevalent point of view at least until the 1970s, that the division that existed between the East and West was something that followed a long tradition, a long history of the Western and Eastern Europe and the division that existed before. The second point in this, I think, and this takes us a little bit more to the present, is the Eric Hobsbawm that has been mentioned here before. And Eric Hobsbawm, in one of his last public interventions, when he reflected about Europe, so what is Europe and, you know, what is the history, what is the future of Europe, he's also making a point which is linked to what I just said now about Eugene Weber. And this is, he says, what we see in Europe, what is the kind of the challenge of Europe, is to bring the periphery and the center together. What he is suggesting is that we have the center of the Western Europe, the Northern Europe, which for many centuries, indeed, economically and politically, was a prosperous part of Europe, and it was the kind of the leading part of Europe. Then we have the peripheries, which is the north, you know, the Nordic countries. We have the south, we have the east. And so far, we were successful, or the Nordic countries were successful enough to integrate into the center. This to a certain, I don't know if there is any coincidence, but if you look at the level of literacy, for example, in the 1870s, you see that it is the Nordic countries which is one of the lowest illiteracy in the whole region. In Austria, Hungary at that time, so 1870, 1875, the illiteracy was about 42%. If you look at the Nordic countries, it's about 1-2%. You know, so again, we're looking at something that's long term. So I would say, if we look externally and internally at the single narrative of this region, I would say it's a narrative that can be constructed on this, and it would be a narrative of a political and social emancipation, something that has not ended, something that's still going on, and something that I think still remains a challenge for the future. Thank you.
Děkuji. Já bych si teď dovolil ještě přečíst dvě otázky, které jsem dostal písemně od pana Vajdy, a pak bych poprosil panelisty a pak uděláme druhé kolečko otázek z publika. Čili mám tady ještě jednu otázku tedy pro všechny panelisty. How do you see the role of nationalism as such as an aftermath of the collapse of communism? A druhá otázka speciálně pro Lukáše Kamińského. Could you specify a little bit more the conspiration theory of the secret services? How deep you think they were involved in the changing process? Takže tyhle dvě otázky a krom toho to, co padlo, jestli chcete ještě se vrátit k těm komentářům, které zazněly z publika. Tak asi necháme to pořadí zase stejné.
Okay, well, thank you for these questions. I think maybe I would like to go back to the issue which was raised about the interplay between the Holocaust and the communism, or the way these events or periods are being remembered publicly, I mean, in official discourses. And I completely agree that with you when you say that we need more in-depth historical research, I think, but it's a great challenge because this issue has become a very hotly debated political issue, and you have a lot of positions which are strongly held by various groups and various politicians, and I think it's really a task for the historians to make it's easy for me because I'm not a historian, but I think there is really a need for such a historical research and to try to depoliticize this issue, which is, in my view, the most burning one at the moment, especially if you look at this idea of a possible discrepancy between the eastern and the western part of the continent. I think it's a very very important issue.
Děkuji, poprosím o krátkou odpověď nebo komentář. Porušuji teď to pravidlo, které jsem sám zmínil, tak poprosím Lukáše Kamińského, na něhož teda byla adresována ještě ta jedna otázka vyloženě k tomu, co říká.
But before I try to answer the question, this direct question, I would like to say a few words about this clash of memories, because it's a problem of our region that because of communist dictatorship, it was not possible to discuss the problems of Second World War for many, many years freely. And many topics like Holocaust, like non-communist resistance were marginalized. And some about some of them, like Soviet crimes, it was in fact forbidden, even mentioned. Or Soviet-German cooperation in the first 2 years of war. So that's why in the 1990s and even now we have this problem that in the same time we have to touch two very important for our nations and serious problems, the Second World War or with all aspects of this war, also the aspect of collaboration of some countries or some parts of nations, even the problem that a part of nations and in some cases state structure took part in the Holocaust. It's a huge problem, and unfortunately we discuss this problem 70 years after the, almost 70 years after the war, but it's still very, very sensitive because it's own image of the nation and etc. And at the same time, we deal with the communist past. The problem was described during this the panel. And the question about the conspiracy theories, we have two different things, in fact, the conspiracy theories and the state of research in the role of secret services played in 1989. And of course we don't have many answers now. There is still more questions than answers. My opinion is that the special services, communist secret services, played own game during the events of 1989 because of various reasons. They tried to have an influence, but in general they failed. So, and in my opinion, the whole revolution was not organized by secret services, but of course many people still believe that they organized everything with KGB.
Děkuji. Poprosil bych Michala Kopečka a zejména, jestli by se mohl vrátit ještě k té otázce o nacionalismu, která zatím nebyla.
Well, this was actually the only thing that I wanted to pick up because we have really not much time and there were many voices. So, well, generally, what was the role of nationalism after communism? There are libraries about it, and you don't expect me to now give you the account of all these libraries. So, I would like to stick maybe just shortly to what we are talking about here, and this is sort of memory and historical narratives, and maybe this time really historiographical narratives or narratives that historians are producing. What we see after 1989 everywhere, and it was also covered by many so already by research, is a comeback of national-centric historical paradigms, and especially in the realm of recent history. Whereas you have, you know, people working out on medieval history or early modern history, they are very much transnational. Most of the production of all the institutions, be it scientific or memory institutions nowadays, are indeed very much nation-centric, especially when it comes to the contemporary history, especially when it comes to post-war period, which does not mean they are decontextualized. What is constructed very carefully usually is obviously the sort of like broader regional connection in communist times to obviously Soviet Union. Also cultural connection to the European values and Europe as such is constructed, but we very rarely actually see really accounts coming from the region which would be comparative, which would be transnational, which would really tackle these things in non-national, as a non-national issues. Now there is also a counter movement of it, I would say. I mean, this is not that bleak as I am now depicting. I mean, there are many approaches, I would say mostly sort of driven by, let's say, younger generation of historians who are sort of picking up to a different narratives, which is based less on, let's say, political history, more on different approaches of social history, be it gender, be it Alltagsgeschichte, be it whatever, environmental history, transnational history. So these are approaches that are now picking up the topics of the post-war period, which are in way sort of maybe not derailing the so far ruling nation-centric history paradigms, but they are definitely correcting it to much extent. Thank you.
Tak děkuji také. Tady vidím tři otázky, tři ruce zvednuté a bohužel se navíc, nebo vezmeme tři, čtyři, ale navíc už se asi nedostane, abychom přeci jenom měli aspoň krátkou přestávku. Takže prosím.
First of all, I want to thank the organizers for giving us the opportunity with this panel to have a wonderful insight into the discussions and interpretations of 1989, and that was really a wonderful lecture in history we had the opportunity to hear here. But the point I want to stress is what is, I think, bringing us together here in Prague. That's the gap in European memory, and especially the gap, and we could see it maybe as a kind of symbolic reconstruction of the Iron Curtain between what Stefan Tröpst has called Holocaust memory and Gulag memory. And it is, of course, the crucial European issue in memory cultures. We have, as we all know, the two, I would say, competing memorial days on the European level. That's the 27th of January, the liberation of Auschwitz, as the Holocaust Memorial Day, and the 23rd of August as the day of, so to say, commemoration of the totalitarian past in Europe. Two points. The one is that this struggle for recognition of the Eastern European position as the Eastern European Erfahrung, so to say, experience, has in some aspects led to a kind of, so to say, a strategy of equalizing the crimes of the National Socialist regime and of the communist regimes. And that's, I think, one crucial point of, so to say, the gap or deepening the gap, because I just want to think of what Sandra Carnite said in 2004, to say if we think of a new Europe, including the eastern part, we have to have this formula that these crimes are equal. The second point, and this is of course not acceptable for many, or in a kind of European culture of remembrance, which sees this, and I think with many good arguments, as a kind of revisionism. The second point, and I think that's one point which is not seen so much, is that the main gap is not the gap between Holocaust and Gulag. It is the gap between inclusion and exclusion, as Rainer Lepsius, and I mentioned him yesterday, put it. That is to say, the difference is if we see these crimes as coming from outside and having not to do anything with our society now, or if coming from the center of our society and, so to say, a point of reference, a point of critical self-awareness, what could have happened in our society. And that's really, but last point, but it took 40 years, it took 40 decades in Western Europe, and the Holocaust was also marginalized in these years. So do we have to wait for some other decades to come to a European understanding? Thank you.
Děkuji. Prosím o předání.
Thank you for the word. I feel publication of the DG information of the European Union, and this is a publication that is Explore Europe. It is written for children. It's very nicely printed. And one chapter is very interesting, relevant for the conference today, and also for this panel discussion, the next one, I think, is bringing the family together. And I'm reading what's printed here. I think you will disagree. I hope you will disagree. Meanwhile, exciting things were happening beyond the EU borders. For many years, the eastern and western parts of Europe had been kept apart. They weren't at war, but their leaders disagreed strongly. I think it was Dubček and Husák, the difference. The rulers of the eastern part believed in a system of government called communism, which did not allow people much freedom. No information about the pressure of the Kremlin. Because of the way they were governed, their countries were poor compared to Western Europe. The division between East and West was so strong, and it was often described as an iron curtain. In many places, not all places, many places, the border was marked by tall fences or high wall, like the one that ran through the city of Berlin and split Germany in two. It was very difficult, not impossible, it was very difficult to get permission to cross the border. Finally, in 1989, the division and disagreement ended. The Berlin Wall was knocked down and the Iron Curtain ceased to exist. Soon Germany was reunited. The people of the central eastern parts of Europe could choose for themselves new governments that got rid of the cold of the old strict communist system. And so it runs further. I hope you disagree with this text, and then come my question, how can we, this was updated in 2010, this text, how can we have better publication about the past, official from the European Union? Thank you.
Tak děkuji, je to otázka skoro na další panel, ale budem se snažit, prosím, o stručnou otázku nebo komentář.
So I think the three panelists for these very interesting insights in the intense debates that have been going on in post-communist countries on the legacy of 89. But what from my perspective is most worrying and the most acute deficit in historical conscience on 89 is not in Eastern Europe, it's in Western Europe. And how do you explain the fact that for the last 25 years there has been so little debate in Western Europe about the significance of 1989 for contemporary politics and for the European Union today? Just there's this very moving interview with Borislav Geremek some weeks before his death, saying, in 2004 I was crying because this was a historical moment, but I saw that in Western Europe people were just thinking about the Polish plumbers who are coming to steal our jobs. And I think there's a shared responsibility of people with political responsibility, academics. It just seems that 1989 is something that happened back there and that is of no importance for us. How do you explain this absence of debate on 1989 as something relevant for Western Europe too?
Děkuji. A poslední otázka, Markus Michal. Omlouvám se všem, na které se nedostalo, bude snad prostor ještě během přestávky nebo později k rozhovoru s tím či oním panelistou. Bohužel času máme limitovaně.
Thank you very much. I only would like to bring another aspect. I think there was the comparison between communism on the one hand and Holocaust on the other hand. I doubt that this is a good couple to compare. I only give you the example, what would to see the National Socialism alone. It is not the same as Holocaust. Really imagine if Hitler had been stopped or stopped itself in 55 years ago. Then he had established a dictatorship. He brought all political enemies to camps. He destroyed Czechoslovakia in a so-called peaceful way, without war. The Western countries had the Munich Agreement to accept it, what happened. And so he had a really strong authoritarian dictatorship in that time without Holocaust. I only try to bring such kind of thought to try that we imagine what happened, what is every time the next step. That's my first point. The second is that I think it is really important that we compare our different communist dimensions. Poland was all the time not the same as, for instance, GDR. And another dimension you have with Romania. And I think it is important for us to compare that too, and not to bring it all under the same calling communism. We should be very much more concrete in these cases. The third point, I think we should bring in, especially this year, when we have the anniversary, 100 years, First World War, the Second World War anniversary, and the linkages. I think that Anna Kamiński would bring together these and to bring out these lines. I think that, for instance, we in Germany very often forget that there were that wars. We very often bring the question of National Socialism on the one hand, of communism on the other hand, but that there were really the war experience. We usually forget or bring it to the background. I think it is important that war experience, which especially Poland and the countries in between have as a deep experience, and it has to be brought up.
Tak děkuji. Byla tady oslovena asi čtyři obrovská témata, o kterých jsou popsány knihovny, ať už je to otázka srovnávání a kladení na jednu rovinu zločinů holokaustu a komunismu, komunistické diktatury, otázka toho těch oficiálních publikací a interpretací, které tam pronikají. Byla tady zmíněno téma nezájmu nebo ignorance v roku 1989 a jeho významu na západě. Je jasné, že to nestihneme teď už v těch třech minutách, třeba co nám zbývají, probrat, ale poprosím přesto panelisty o aspoň selektivní výběr nebo pár slov k některým z těchto témat na závěr této debaty. Takže prosím, Laure, Neumayer.
Okay, so briefly, the question about why 1989 was ignored in Western Europe, I think it's an illustration of this kind of center and periphery vision of Europe, and the fact that in Western Europe, in France, for example, Eastern Europe still seems or like some kind of distant periphery which is not relevant to our national context. And I think that the enlargement and the issue of the Polish plumber was a perfect example of that kind of widespread ignorance, indifference, and which made it the perfect theme for Eurosceptics and populists. And I think that's a sad fact that we have this very Western oriented view of what Europe is, although I mean the Berlin Wall fell 25 years ago and the EU enlarged 10 years ago, so it's kind of, I mean, at least for French politicians or French elites, this kind of very narrow-minded and national-minded view on what's relevant and what's important for the country. And your point about communism and Nazism, I fully agree with what everything you said, and obviously I just used those terms, but in a, as a shortcut, which is not rigorous enough, so I completely agree with you.
Díky, Łukasz Kamiński.
I'd like to shortly comment this competition of memories, and I think this competition is not inevitable. I see at least one common ground for both memories. It's a remembrance of the victims. And I think if we focus on victims, there will be some common ground between these two memories, remembering about all differences and similarities between two totalitarian regimes. And the question about the West, the lack of debate on the West, I cannot really answer this question. I can only comment that I can see something very similar now in last years. For example, lack of interest in Arab Springs. You know, in Poland, it was one of the main topics for many months. Poland sent many experts, including our institute experts, to Tunisia, for example, to help first the revolution and then to help to prepare a change of the system. And last year I was paying official visit in Paris, just a few days before the next visit in Tunis, and I asked some officials what is their opinion as a French politicians, etc., about this problem, and the common answer was, oh, we are interested only in Algeria, we don't know anything about Tunisia. So, and a few weeks ago I was in Berlin during these dramatic moments on Maidan. I didn't see too many people interested in problem of Ukraine. It's probably the difference of experiences. It's still a kind of iron curtain, still existing. We feel in other ways. So maybe this way.
Díky. Michal Kopeček.
Okay, just one point to actually the question somehow is generally simmering here, and it is this different perceptions and difficulties of communications of different memories. Now I wonder, and here this is just a sort of amateur view, I'm not a sociologist of memory, but I wonder to what extent there is also at stake a difference between the memory of dictatorship and memory of the war. Generally, it seems that obviously dictatorships are very much usually contested at home, since obviously the trauma of the dictatorship is potentially, and sometimes not even potentially, dividing these societies. It takes really very long time in order to overcome. Whereas the wars, and especially the Second World War, which is the basis of the European identity, is much more at the same time contested among the nations and among the former enemy countries. It's very problematic, obviously, to forge any common narrative about the Second World War in Europe, apart from the normative memory of the Holocaust, which also tells us why this is such an important background of European memory. Now, yesterday, James Mark has shown on the example of Polish 1989 how the issue that is hotly contested at home, that is the nature and meaning of the regime change, can become almost idyllic historical story once it is raised to the European story of democratization. And it's the same, seems to me, counts also for many other European dictatorships. Once they are raised to the level of European story for the fight for democracy against dictatorship, it is quite idyllically consensual, whereas the story of Second World War has is the other way around. I mean, there is a potential, it has a potential of more consensus at home and of much less consensus at the European level apart from the Holocaust. Thank you.
Tak děkuji všem panelistům, děkuji i vám za velmi živou diskuzi. Škoda, že nemůže pokračovat. Omlouvám se za to, co vypadá jako nedisciplinovanost, ale začali jsme o 20 minut později, končíme o 15 minut později, takže jsme stáhli zpoždění o 5 minut. Bohužel tedy přestávka i tak bude trochu kratší. Díky všem a hezký zbytek tohoto dne i celé konference.